If you have your Bibles all standing, we are turning to the book of Matthew, chapter 25. Matthew 25. And we're going to look at verses 1 through 13. Matthew 25, verses 1 through 13. And it reads as follows. It says, "Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight," at the church say midnight.
Midnight.
"And at midnight there was a cry made, Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh." Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for another day, and thank you, Lord, for who you are. Lord, as I stand here and proclaim your word, please decrease all of me and increase all of you. Holy Spirit, have your way. It's in Jesus' name that I do pray. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. This month we're in another series entitled The Parables of Jesus. The Parables of Jesus. This is part 2 of The Parables of Jesus. The subtopic for today is Don't Be a Fool. Don't be a fool. Myself, I like to prepare what I'm going to wear the night before I get up in the morning to go somewhere. Elder Coleman, I get my clothes out the night before. I get my shoes out the night before. I get everything I'm going to wear the night before. I make sure everything is ironed. I make sure everything match up. Even if I'm going to wear, you know, cufflinks to come to church the next morning, I'll make sure that my cufflinks are out. I have everything laid out. I am prepared for the next morning. I do that the night before. I make sure everything is laid out and I'm ready to go. I have my shoes. I have my socks. I know the belt I'm going to wear. I know what I'm going to wear. Even if I were to wear a tie, I would sometimes even tie the tie that night before, so it saves me time in the morning. Being that we come here every Sunday morning, I even make sure that I have everything prepared the night before. I put everything together, put everything in the truck the night before. Everything is ready the night before. I am prepared for the next morning. Unlike someone else in my household that shall remain nameless this morning, that person does not fully prepare the night before. This certain person, who am I going to call any names, they like to do things the morning of. They would get out one outfit, try on that outfit, take that outfit off, put on another outfit with some more shoes, because the shoes don't match the outfit, the outfit don't match the earrings don't match the necklace. They try 4 and 5 and 6 and sometimes 7 outfits. They do that the morning of. They don't get things out the night of. They do it the morning of. And I can't operate like that myself. I have to know what I'm going to wear, what I am going to do. Whatever I get out the night before, you can best believe I'm wearing that in the morning. I'm not going to switch it up, V. Whatever I get out the night before, that's what I'm going to wear. But this other person, Michelle, remain nameless. They do things the morning of, and they switch it up several times. And for some reason, Drew, I think she may have peeked at my sermon, because believe it or not, maybe the Holy Spirit spoke to her, and she only got on one outfit today. I don't know what happened this morning, but this person, Michelle, remain nameless, only got one outfit out, and she still has it on. Don't know what happened. Maybe the Holy Spirit went and spoke to this person. They shall remain names. They call no names. They ain't call no names this morning. But I like to be fully prepared myself. Now, this story about these 10 virgins is about being prepared. It's about them being prepared. Now, I told you last week that a parable is simply an earthly story, but it has a heavenly meaning behind it. The parable in itself is not a true story, but it's some truth within the parable. So within this parable, let's look at it. Let's pull out the truth within this parable. Verse 1, it says, "Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom." So here, the 10 virgins collectively took their lamps, and as a group, they went out to see the bridegroom. So by looking at this text, by looking at this parable, all 10 of these virgins, they have lamps. That cannot be disputed. But let's read further in the text. Verse 2, it says, "And 5 of them were wise, and 5 of them were foolish." So it reiterates that there are 10 virgins. But it goes further, and it distinguishes the mental aptitude of these virgins. It distinguishes the mindset of these virgins. It distinguishes who had common sense and who did not. It's saying, yeah, we have 10 virgins here, but 5 of these are wise, and the other 5 are foolish. 5 of these understand what's going on, but the other 5 don't have a clue. 5 of these are on the fast track, but the other 5 are 2 fries short of a happy meal. 5 of these, they use the both sides of their brain, but the other 5 act like they don't have a brain at all. 5 were wise, and 5 were foolish. So why does the Bible say 5 were wise and 5 were foolish? Well, let's look at verse number 3 and verse number 4. Verse 3 says, "They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them." So the 5 foolish virgins, they took their lamps, but they didn't take any extra oil with them. Let's look at the other virgins here. Verse number 4, it says, "But the wise took their oil in their vessels with their lamps." They took oil in their vessels, and they took it along with their lamps. So here we see that the 5 wise virgins, they not only took their lamps, but they had a little extra oil with them. The Bible says that they took oil in their vessels. You may be reading from a translation where it talks about them taking the extra oil in their flasks. They had extra oil with them. So here is the situation in the text. We have a total of 10 virgins. 5 are wise, 5 are foolish. And the Bible says that the wise virgins are the ones who took not only their lamps, but they took extra oil just in case. But the 5 foolish ones, they only took their lamp, and they decided not to bring anything extra. They decided not to have a backup plan. They decided not to have a plan B. Why is that so important? Well, let's continue to read the parable. Let's see why this is so important. Verses 5 through 7, it says, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. So all of the virgins, watch this, all of the virgins are asleep. The bridegroom was away, but all of a sudden, the Bible says that at midnight there was a cry made. In other words, somebody shouted at midnight. A cry was made at midnight. And the bridegroom said, and someone said, the bridegroom is here. It's time to go and meet him. All of them are asleep. And a shout came at midnight, and they were awakened by the shout. And the Bible says that all of the virgins, they get up and they go out to meet the bridegroom. Verse 7 says they trimmed their lamps. In other words, they prepared their lamps. And as they were preparing their lamps, verse 8 says that the 5 foolish virgins asked the 5 wise virgins for some of their oil, because their lamp had run out of oil. The 5 foolish ones, they went to the 5 wise ones and said, give me some of your oil. Now, you have to understand that they needed oil in their lamps before they were to go out and meet the bridegroom. Back in biblical days, back in Jesus' day, what would happen is that on the night of a marriage, the bridegroom would be at the bride's house the night before. And they would have different ceremonies, different festivals, different things happening at the bride's house. But when it's time for the bridegroom to leave the bride's house and go to his house, a procession would follow him, and it would be a crowd of people going along with him. And they would have their own torches or their own lamps in this procession. Now, if you did not have a lamp, they would consider you a party crasher. They would think you are a wedding crasher. They didn't know who you was. Like, who are you trying to crash the party? Because your lamp is not lit. So everyone in the procession along with the bridegroom needed to have their lamps lit. If your lamp was not lit, they would have thought you was a party crasher. They thought you was a wedding crasher. You need to have some kind of proof that you belong in the midst of the party. You need to have some kind of proof that you belong in the midst of this crowd. Like, who are you? Carrying a lamp, you don't have no light, it's not lit, you don't have any extra oil with them. Who are you? Are you trying to crash the party? You don't have any kind of proof whatsoever. And Elder Coleman, that's just like it is today. In society today, you have people who say they're following Jesus, but they don't have any sort of proof. They say they follow the commands of God, but their lifestyle says something completely different. They can act like the devil Monday through Saturday, but on Sunday morning, they are an angel in the house of the Lord. They will tweet and they will post about God is my all in all in one breath, but in the next tweet, in the next breath, in the same sentence, sometimes they'll curse God out and they'll curse other people out in a well-known tone. They say one thing, but the lifestyle say another. They can find every scripture they possibly can on the blessings of God and the prosperity of God and how God loves me and this, that, and the other, but they act like they're hooked on phonics when it comes down to the judgment of God and when it comes down to living right and living holy and the sin that may be in them. Oh, they can't read none of those scriptures, but they'll find something on a blessing. They'll find something about God bringing his blessings down on them. They want to know that God loves them even if they're living in sin. Ain't trying to live right. You need some kind of proof. The five foolish virgins' word is your oil. Your word is the proof that you need to have. The wise virgins, they responded to these foolish virgins, verse number 9, when they came to them and asked them for some of their oil. Verse 9 says, but the wise answered, saying, not so, lest there be not enough for us and you, but go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. The wise virgins weren't just wise because they said no, but they were wise because they were prepared. They were wise because they were prepared. And on the other hand, the foolish virgins, they were not prepared. They were unprepared. And they assumed that the wise virgins would bail them out of trouble. They thought the wise virgins would give them some of their extra oil that they had. But instead, they told them that what they needed to do was go to the marketplace, go to the store, go around the corner, and get your own oil. You need to get oil for yourself. I can't give you any of the oil in which I have. You need to go to the store. You need to go to Walmart. You need to go to Pub. You need to go somewhere and get oil for yourself. After all, that's what we did. We didn't wait till the last minute. We didn't wait till the last day. We didn't wait till the last second. We got our oil in enough time. And by the way, when you were sleeping, what were you doing sleeping? You should have been sleeping. What you should have been doing was shopping. Instead of sleeping, you should have been shopping. You shouldn't have been sleeping. And I found out, Elder Coleman, that today a lot of people, they are sleeping on Jesus. A lot of people, they are sleeping on Jesus when they should be shopping for him. They're sleeping on Jesus, but they really should be shopping for him. And after all, he's not that hard to find. All you have to do is just call on his name. A lot of times, we just need to go do some Jesus shopping. We need to go shop for Jesus because the world needs to go Jesus shopping. The White House needs to go Jesus shopping. The schools need to go Jesus shopping. Corporate America needs to go Jesus shopping. False prophets needs to go Jesus shopping. The LGBT community needs to go Jesus shopping. We need to go Jesus shopping. When you look at the menu, you say, give me a little bit of this, a little bit of that. Oh, and give me all of that. We need to go Jesus shopping. He's not hard to find. We need all of Jesus. I know there is a song out there saying, give me just a little bit of Jesus. I don't quite understand that song. How can you get a little bit of Jesus? How can you get a tad bit of Jesus? Don't give me a little. Give me all of Jesus. I need all of Jesus. I need everything that he has. I don't need a little bit. You can't get a little bit of Jesus. That's why you need to pay close attention to songs. Hey, Father, my Holy Spirit, talking to you. You need to pay close attention to what you hear. All songs are not biblical songs. We when you get all of Jesus, if you get a portion of Jesus, you get all of him. You get all of him. And I hope you know what I'm talking about when I say go shop for Jesus. Because you can't purchase Jesus. He can't be bought. You can't purchase something where someone's going to give you all of them. You can't purchase for him. And when you receive him, you receive everything that comes along with him. You get the whole kit and caboodle. You get everything that comes along with him. When you receive Jesus, you get the grace. You get the mercy. You get the judgment. You get the forgiveness. You get the patience. You get the love. And once you receive salvation, you also get the sanctification and the justification. But best believe it, all done for his glorification. You get all of Jesus. When you get Jesus, you get the whole thing. So these five wise virgins, they had extra oil. But the five foolish ones, they did not have anything extra. And since the wise virgins was not going to give any of their extra oil, the foolish virgins decided to go and purchase their own oil. They decided that they needed to go to the marketplace to get some oil. But let's read what happens in verse number 10. We almost done. Verse 10 says, "And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut." The door was shut. The bridegroom came, the wise virgins went in with him, and the door was shut. So the foolish virgins, that they leave to go purchase their oil for their lamps, because now they see that it's real. they see now that it's real. They see that although he tarried, he came just like he said he would. Now all of a sudden, it's an emergency that you now need the oil. Grace Center, don't be a fool. I hope you have some oil in your lamps. Don't be a fool, and don't be a fool and wait till the last minute to check out before you check in. Don't be a fool, Grace Center. The foolish virgins, they went to purchase oil, and while they are away, the parable says, the text says, that the bridegroom came as they were away. And when the bridegroom came, he received the five wise virgins, and they all went to the marriage feast. As they make their way to the feast, the parable says that the door was shut behind them. The wise virgins made it inside of the marriage feast. As they make it inside of the marriage feast, the parable says that the door was shut behind them. Oh, it should have been a bounce for the last Tuesday night. We had a great time last. The Holy Spirit took over bounce that we went to a whole other realm in the bounce study. Because we talked about that when you leave this earth, you don't get enough chance. You don't want that door to shut behind you. You don't want to be a fool. You don't want to wait till the last minute and think you got everything under control. With that door shut, that is it. You don't get a do-over. You don't get a second chance. When that door is shut, that's it. It's final when that door is shut. So the door shut, Drew. And the wise virgins, they went in to the marriage feast with the bridegroom. But guess who comes up after the door is shut? Yeah, you know who it is. The wise virgins are in there chilling. They're relaxing. They have a good old time, Sam. They're with the bridegroom. Chilling. But then a knock comes at the door. But the door is shut. And they can't get in. And they can't get in they thought that time was on their side. They were the ones who said, I will get right whenever I get right. They waited till the last minute to get themselves in order. When they came back from shopping, they said, Lord, Lord, we're here now. We're back from our shopping spree. We have our oil that was calling out the name of the Lord. But what a tragedy of them being late. What a tragedy of them being unprepared. What a tragedy and a travesty of them not being ready. Verse 12 says, but he answered and said, verily I say unto you, I know you not. Translation, I don't know you. I don't know who you are. These virgins, these five foolish virgins, thought they could still make it in at the last minute when the door was shut. They thought they had plenty of time to get oil for their lamps, but they waited because they thought that they had more time. They thought they could get in whenever they wanted to get in. They thought they could make it in even though the door was shut. And unfortunately, if people don't receive Jesus Christ, it's going to be too late when that door shut. You don't have the key to the door. The only one that has the key to the door is Jesus Christ. Don't wait till the last minute to try to get in. Once that door closed, that door is closed. You need to be prepared. If you don't have any oil for your lamps, get some oil for your lamps. When I do the invitation, come down if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. And maybe I'm preaching to the choir today, but I don't know. I'm preaching anyway. The Holy Spirit gave it to me. Maybe you're watching this on YouTube or social media. You don't know Jesus Christ. You need to receive Jesus Christ. Don't wait until the door is shut. Receive him today. Don't be a fool. Don't be like these five foolish virgins. Make sure you have your lamps. Make sure you have oil in your lamps, but also pack some extra oil with you. Because watch this, verse 13, it says that we don't know the day nor the hour on when he's going to come back. He could come back before I say amen and close this sermon.
Yes.
He could come back before you can make it to the restaurant for brunch. He could come back before you even make it to your doorstep. We don't know when he's coming back. But one day he is coming back. And if you shall leave this earth even before he come back, you still need to receive him today. So whether you're in here or watching this by playback, if you don't know Jesus Christ, you need to receive him today. I wasn't even going to preach this today, though, because I was to preach something else today, but the Holy Spirit shifted me in the middle of the week, so I need to preach this right here. So I don't know who I'm talking to. If you don't know Jesus Christ, you need to receive him today. Be wise, but don't be a fool. And I'm not being mean when I say don't be a fool. The Bible, Jesus will sometimes call you a fool. If you're a fool, you're a fool. This parable talks about the five foolish virgins. And you will be a fool for not receiving Jesus Christ. All of the benefits that goes along with it. Who don't want to go to heaven? Who don't want to go to a place where there's no more pain, there's no more agony? You live there forever and ever. Every need will be met. You won't look. You won't have the aches and pains when you get up in the morning. There'll be no more headaches, Elder Coleman.
Yes,
there'll be no more stress. There'll be no more worry. You have everything that you need in glory.
Yes.
Don't be like the five foolish virgins. And all these jokes about, I'll take my chances going to hell, and I'll keep the devil out. Oh, okay, all right. You bad. You keep the devil out of hell. Okay, all right. Stop all that nonsense. Stop being a fool. Receive Jesus Christ, the one who has the key to the marriage feast. The five wise ones, they were wise because they were prepared and because they were ready. Be ready when that sky cracks and Jesus comes back, or be ready if you leave this earth before that time. Either way it go, you need to be ready. Now, I know it's not a popular message. Maybe I'll talk about blessings next month or next year. I don't want to talk about blessings or whatever. But for today, if you don't know Jesus Christ, you need to receive him today. Don't be a fool. Be wise. And if you don't know him, receive him today. Don't put off today, or don't put off till tomorrow what you can do today. Receive him today. You don't know when he's coming back. You don't know when he's going to leave this earth. You can lay down at night and not wake up in the morning.
Yeah.
Receive him today and don't be a fool. Yeah. Amen. All stand in the doors of the church.